Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Thank you very much. Welcome to Beautiful Savior this morning. It is an honor and a great joy to worship with all of you. We welcome our guests, those of you who are with us for the first or maybe second or third time. We welcome all of our members who have been with us for many, many years. It's an honor. And wherever you have been this past week and wherever the next week is going to take you, our Lord Jesus himself is here to meet you. He's here to meet you in his word. He's here to meet you in the sacrament. He's here to bring you his grace and his peace and his mercy today. And we continue in the Lord's Prayer sermon series. Pastor Joe will be preaching about the first petition, Hallowed be thy name. And our prayer is that God will reveal and share with you just how important that name is, and the ways that it can be holy in our lives, and in fact should be holy in our lives by God's grace. Would you please rise and we'll begin our worship. And we worship today in the name of our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The liturgy will be on the screens for you this morning. Let's join in singing our gathering hymn. Friends, before God and in the company of our sisters and brothers in Christ in this place, let us confess our sin together. God eternal, three in one and one in three.
We confess that we have sinned against you, God, Lord, and thee. We have thought error ourselves and others. We have told lies, said hurtful things, acted in ways we wish we could take back, and looked the other way when action was needed. In your mercy, O God, forgive us, cleanse us, and heal us, for the sake of Jesus our Savior. Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Everything has become new. In our Lord Jesus Christ, you are a new creation. Your sins are taken away and you are made new. So be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. Amen. Let us pray. O God, throughout the ages you judge your people with mercy, and you inspire us to speak your truth. By your Spirit, anoint us for lives of faith and service, and bring all people into your forgiveness. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Kim.
Okay, good morning. I would like to invite the children to come down for the children's message. You can come if you're a visitor or if you're here all the time. If you have a grown-up, you can bring your grown-up with you or a big brother with you. Come on down. Good morning. Good to see you guys. Happy summer, huh? Yeah. That makes me smile, too. Good morning. Come on in, you guys. Good to see you today. Yeah. Hey, you guys. How are you? Okay. All right. Hey, you guys. On the count of three, I want you to say your name out loud, okay? You ready? On the count of three, say your name out loud. One, two, three. Good. Oh, yeah. Yeah, a little uptake there. Okay, let me ask you something. Have you ever wanted to talk into a microphone? Would you like to say your name into the microphone? Anybody? Anybody? Let's try this. This is an experiment I have. I'm going to say my name into the microphone. I'm going to say to all these people, I'm going to say, hi, my name is Kim, and then they're going to look back at me and say, hi, Kim. Okay, should we try it? And then if you want to try it, you can try it. Let's see how it goes. I'm going to take the microphone off in case you want to turn. Okay. Hi, my name is Kim.
Hi, Kim.
That was cool. Anybody want to try it? You want to try it? Say, hi, my name is...
Say Ben?
No.
Can you say Ben?
You guys want to try it? No. You guys want to try it? No takers. You want to do it? You're shaking your head. Say, hi, my name is...
Hi, my name is... Avery.
Avery? Hi, Avery. Awesome. Well, that was cool, wasn't it? Yeah. You guys want to try it? Was that cool to have all those people say your name? I thought it was pretty cool, too. You know, when people use our names, we like that because it means that they know us, right? Yeah, I like when people use my name. We use our names that we were given, that our parents gave us when we were born. And then we also use special names for people that have special roles in our lives. Like, say, for instance, you came to my class, you would call me teacher, right? Because I'm your teacher. Or what if someone came to your house to put out a fire? What would you call them? Yeah, firefighter. What if you were sick and you had to go in to get better? What would you call that person that came to make you better? Yeah, a doctor. So we use names like that for people that play special roles. But we also use one name that only applies to one thing. There's only one time that we use this name, and for only this one person and one God, and that's the name of God. And in the Lord's Prayer that we've been talking about, we started last week, didn't we? We started talking about the Lord's Prayer and how it gets used in our lives, not just when we pray, but in other ways. This is the week we're going to talk about the name of God. So last week it was, our Father who art in heaven. What comes after that? You guys know? Hallowed be thy name. Right. And hallowed is another way of saying holy. Holy is your name, God, because God's name is holy. Now, we don't say it in our prayer because God needs to hear us say it. He knows he's holy. He knows his name is holy. He doesn't need us to say it. But we say holy is your name because we say, God, I know you're holy. Now, how can I make your name holy in my life? How can I show that to other people? That's what that means. That has a lot of meaning, doesn't it? So let's talk about that. If we're going to make God's name holy in our lives, that means that we're going to show how much we know that he loves us, the relationship that we have with him, and we're going to show other people that, and we want to show that in all the actions that we have. So let me ask you a question. Is it showing God's name is holy when you take a toy away from somebody? Does that show that God is good and that you believe that and it doesn't, does it? Does it show that God is loving and good if you share toys with people? Absolutely, because you're showing love and goodness. Is it showing that God is good when you disobey your mom and dad when they tell you to do something and you stomp off? Is that a good thing? No. Is it showing that God's name is holy and that God is good when you hear what your parents say and even if you don't want to, you say, okay, I will, Mom, I will, Dad. Is that showing God's goodness? It is. You know, our actions talk to other people about what we believe. And when we love Jesus and we know how much he loves us, we want to show that. It's an awesome gift that we want to show to other people. So when you are acting this week, when you are doing things with people, when you're talking to people, when you're spending time with people, remember that you're saying, hallowed be thy name, every time that you show love to others. Okay? Can you pray about that with me? And let's do this. Let's, in our prayer, ask Jesus for help, because it's not easy to do that. And we know we're going to make mistakes, but we're going to ask God to help us. Okay? So will you fold your hands and pray with me? Dear God, your name is holy. Please help me to show that in my life, even when I mess up. Please help me start over. I love you, Jesus. Amen. All right, you guys. Have an awesome sunny day.
A reading from 2 Samuel. When Uriah's wife heard that her husband was dead, she mourned for him. After the time of mourning was over, David had her brought to his house, and she became his wife and bore him a son. But the thing David had done displeased the Lord. The Lord sent Nathan to David. When he came to him, he said, "There were two men in a certain town, one rich and the other poor. The rich man had a very large number of sheep and cattle, but the poor man had nothing except one little ewe lamb that he had bought. He raised it, and it grew up with him and his children. It shared his food, drank from his cup, and even slept in his arms. It was like a daughter to him. Now a traveler came to the rich man, but the rich man refrained from taking one of his own sheep or cattle to prepare a meal for the traveler who had come to him. Instead, he took the ewe lamb that belonged to the poor man and prepared it for the one who had come to him." David burned with anger against the man and said to Nathan, "As surely as the Lord lives, the man who did this deserves to die. He must pay for that lamb four times over, because he did such a thing and had no pity." Then Nathan said to David, "You are the man. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I anointed you king over Israel, and I delivered you from the hand of Saul. I gave your master's house to you and your master's wives into your arms. I gave you the house of Israel and Judah. And if all this had been too little, I would have given you even more. Why do you despise the word of the Lord by doing what is evil in his eyes? You struck down Uriah the Hittite with the sword and took his wife to be your own. You killed him with the sword of the Ammonites. Now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own." Then David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord." Nathan replied, "The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die. But because by doing this you have made the enemies of the Lord show utter contempt, the son born to you will die." After Nathan had gone home, the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife had borne to David, and he became ill. The word of the Lord. Has its being by your word.
and I'm honored to sing your praise. King of glory, God Almighty, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be.
Reading from Galatians. We who are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners know that a man is not justified by observing the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. So we too have put our faith in Christ Jesus, that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by observing the law, because by observing the law, no one will be justified. If, while we seek to be justified in Christ, it becomes evident that we ourselves are sinners, does that not mean that Christ promotes sin? Absolutely not. If I rebuild what I destroyed, I prove that I am a lawbreaker. For through the law, I died to the law, so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him, so he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman who had lived a sinful life in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned towards the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say among themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." After this, Jesus traveled from one town and village to another, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him, and also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases: Mary, called Magdalene, from whom 7 demons had come out; Joanna, the wife of Cusa, the manager of Herod's household; Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, as we continue in our sermon series on the Lord's Prayer, I would invite you to look at the screen or open your service folder on the inside page. There we're going to read together that first petition, and I'll read the what does this mean and also how is God's name kept holy. But you'll see it there on the screen or in your service folder, and I invite you to read this along with me. Could we get it on the screens, please? Thank you. And if you can't read that, I encourage you to use the service folder as it's there. Might be hard to read. We'll fix that for the future. So let's read together. Hallowed be thy name. Let's try that again. Come on, guys. Here we go. Here we go. Hallowed be thy name. There we go. What does this mean? God's name is certainly holy in itself, but we pray in this petition that it may be kept holy among us also. How is God's name kept holy? God's name is kept holy when the Word of God is taught in its truth and purity. And we, as the children of God, also lead holy lives according to it. Help us to do this, dear Father in heaven. But anyone who teaches or lives contrary to God's word profanes the name of God among us. Protect us from this, Heavenly Father. So as I said last week, Pastor Tom got us started on the introduction to the Lord's Prayer with the Our Father who art in heaven. And in that sermon, Pastor Tom talked about how prayer is not a business transaction between us and God. Rather, it's a family connection. It's a family relationship that is taking place in that prayer. And from that connection, from that relationship, we actually see the answer to the question of who I am to you. Who I am to God. That while we are unworthy because of our sin, God invites us, He welcomes us, and He encourages us to come to Him in prayer daily and constantly because of Christ and what He has done for you and for me. Well, today we continue in that same question, who I am to you, only rather than looking at it in terms of God and us, we are looking at it in terms of us and other people, our friends, our families, our coworkers, asking ourselves the question of who we are to them. Now, that may seem a little bit odd because as we just read the first petition, it's hallowed be thy name, right? So it seems it would be more based on God's name than really about who we are to other people. But that's where the what does this mean comes in, right? Where we're told that God's name is kept holy by itself, but we would pray in this petition that God's name would become holy among us also. And there's an important truth in that what does this mean, that God's name is kept holy by itself. That means it's not dependent on us to keep it holy or to make it holy, set apart, or different. God's name by itself is already different. It's already set apart. It is already holy, and it's not on us to keep it that way or make it that way. And you know what? Praise God for that, dear friends. Praise God that it's not up to us to make God's name holy, because if that were the case, then He would be no different. He would be no more set apart than the gods of the rest of the world, the Buddhas, the Krishnas, the Allahs. But also, dear friends, we can praise God that His name is already holy by itself, because it means that that name will always be the same, that it will never change, that as we go to God in prayer, we know that that is the name that we can call upon as we go to Him in prayer, that it doesn't change, that it doesn't change with our days, that it doesn't change with how we're feeling or what we're going through or whatever else it may be, that it is the name that we can always call upon, the name that is above all names. So this raises the question, right? If God's name is kept holy by itself, then why pray this petition? Why worry about it at all? Right? It seems kind of maybe a little redundant or unnecessary to pray this petition, hallowed be thy name. Well, that's again where we go back into the what does this mean? Because really what we're praying for then in this petition is that God's name would be kept holy among us also. Now, what we're not saying with this is that we're trying to keep God's name so set apart and different that we never use it, right? That we never talk about it, that we never use it in terms of conversations or actions with other people. Nor are we asking God to kind of circle the wagons, right? And keep everything closed off from the rest of the world. In fact, what we are asking God in this petition is the exact opposite of those two points. That we would use God's name openly and freely as we go through this life, as we engage the world, that we would actually have conversations about who God is and how holy, how set apart, how different He is from the rest of the world. Dear friends, in this petition, we are asking that God would encourage us and strengthen us to go into the world, to engage the world with His name, with how different, how set apart He is. And that that difference, that set apartness, becomes part of our lives as well as we engage the world, so that we don't blend in and disappear, but rather stand out from what's happening in the world around us, this broken and sin-filled world. So what does that look like, right? We could talk about being holy, we could talk about being set apart, being different, but those are all abstract thoughts, right? They're kind of up in the clouds, nothing really for us to grab onto and make our own. But that's the wonderful thing about God's Word, is that it provides for us an opportunity to see what this looks like. There's a great example for us to see in Scripture, and that's Colossians 3, verses 1 through 17. Now, I'd encourage you, if you have a Bible with you this morning, to open up to it. It's quite a long passage. Or if you have an app on your phone, to go ahead and pop that open. Probably be the only time that I'll invite you to use your phone in church, right? So feel free to open that up and take a look. Colossians 3, 1 through 17. We're going to be using the NIV 1984 edition. It'll also be on the screen. And again, it's a longer passage, but it really speaks to the difference, the set apartness that comes that God's name become holy in our lives as Christians as well. Okay, so Colossians 3, 1 through 17. So please listen for those differences as I read. Please listen to how it's set apart from the rest of the world. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will also appear with Him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. So here we go, right? Here come some of the differences. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived, but now you must also rid yourselves of all such things as these. Another list. Anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its Creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy, my own wording here, set apart, different, and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. So there you go. Those are some descriptions as to what it means to be different, to be set apart from the rest of the world. And so with that passage in mind, with Colossians 3, 1 through 17 in mind, I have to go back to the question that's asked at the beginning of the sermon, that question of who I am to you. If you ask that question of your family, of your friends, of your coworkers, your employees, your employers, if you ask them that question, how would they respond? How would they respond if you ask them who I am to you? Would they see these differences? Would they see this set apartness that Colossians talks about, that Paul writes about in that book? Would he see love that is undeserving toward other people? Would they see forgiveness that is above all forgiveness, a forgiveness that can only be found in Christ alone? You see, dear friends, more often than not, I think if we ask this question of our coworkers, our friends, our families, we would find out that we blend in most of the time rather than stand apart, that we're more one of the guys than someone who is different from the rest of the world. And that's why we continually go back to the Lord's Prayer, not just in our weekly prayers here at Beautiful Savior, but also our daily prayers. Because in this prayer, we are not only reminded, strengthened, and encouraged that we are different, that we are called to be different, but we are also reminded of the answer to the question of who we are to God. That yes, we are unworthy because of our sin, yet we are still loved. A love that was made real when Christ came to this world, when he died on the cross and rose again. A love that has and will always be with us as we go through this life. A love that has and always will forgive us as we go through the struggles and the mistakes of this life. A love that has and will always encourage us to go to God in prayer, no matter what it may be, no matter what we may be going through, because we know that he is there and that he will listen because of his love, his mercy, his forgiveness for us as his people. And dear friends, as we pray the Lord's Prayer today, it's my hope and prayer that as we say amen, that it's not the end for us. That as we go into this world, we are not only reminded of who we are to God, but that we are also reminded of the job that God has prepared in advance for us to do out there in the rest of the world, out there in Plymouth, Minnesota. Did you know, dear friends, that in Plymouth, almost 50% of churches, or 50% of homes are unchurched? 50%, almost 50% of homes are unchurched. That doesn't mean that they don't go to church, but they believe in Jesus. It means that they don't believe in Jesus whatsoever. So to put that into another number for you, 35,000 people. 35,000 people. Our friends, our family, our coworkers, our employees, all sorts of people who need what we need, who need the love of God that is found in Christ alone. And so it's my hope and prayer that as we leave here today, as we go out into that world, as we go into our neighborhoods, our communities, that we are not only strengthened and encouraged to be different, to be set apart, to keep God's name holy in our own lives, but also that we are encouraged to witness to others of how great, how different, how holy our God is, so that they see him and come to know who they are to him. Children who are loved, children who are called his own. And may God grant that for Jesus' sake. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Joel. Would you please rise? Living together in trust and hope, living together in the name of our God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let us confess our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty,
creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit
stay standing for prayer. Thank you. Let us pray to our Father for the church, for those in need, and for all of God's creation.
Faithful God, inspire fidelity in your church. Guard it from temptation and make it a place of safety, welcome, and joy for all, especially here at Trinity Lutheran Church in Haintsville, Alabama, St. Luke's Lutheran Church in Warland, Wyoming, and St. John's Evangelical Lutheran Church and School in Corcoran. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of all that is, we encounter you not only in the grandeur of your creation, but in its smallest and quietest parts. Awaken us to your presence all around us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of power and might, call the nations of the world to recognize first your authority and justice. Guard all nations from unjust rulers and bring forth your kingdom of righteousness. Spread peace throughout the world and send comfort and hope to all affected by the terror attacks in Tel Aviv and Orlando, Florida. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the lowly, help us recognize hospitality and generosity from unexpected sources, the humanity and goodness of those in prison, the faith and persistence of those who weep. Let our weakness be our strength. We pray especially for those we name before you now, silently or aloud.
Father, this morning I bring before you Susie and Bob and Joanne and Don and Jonathan.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign God, equip us to make informed decisions this election season, and guide us as a nation to seek paths of truth, mercy, and justice. Give wisdom and strength to all who lead us, and sustain with courage those who serve in our military. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we thank you for the many gifts you have given us and for guiding us to share them with others through Kingdom Impact. Lead us in joyfully and generously keeping our commitments, and give us discernment as we plan future ministry. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of new life, as you bring newcomers, visitors, and seekers into this assembly, give us hearts open to the new perspectives and gifts they bring. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, you have called the saints to be your own. Be with all who mourn this day, especially Tom and Ruth Tesh and family. Gather us with the saints into your kingdom in the promise of life forever with you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting your promise to hear us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We continue to worship joyfully as we engage in our offering.
Please rise. Let us pray. God of mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Fill us with good things at your table, that we may come to help all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the same night he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Peace, Lord. Are members of our prayer ministry team available for you today following your reception of the sacrament or following worship in the prayer room, which is right out those doors of the sanctuary. And we invite you, if you would like to have someone pray with you about a need or a joy, they would be honored to do so with you. And folks, we have heard and we have received Christ in the Word, and this is Christ in this sacrament, under these bread and wine, these forms of bread and wine. This is the one, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Come in faith and receive him into yourself. Please be seated.
Thank you.
the true body and true blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you and lift you up in the true faith unto life everlasting. Go in his peace and in his joy. Amen.
Let us pray. Wise and generous God, we thank you that at this holy table you have fed us again with the food of everlasting life. Send us with your blessing to seek the good of our neighbor and call others to your feast. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. Two announcements for you today, actually one in two parts. Coming up in the next few weeks here at Beautiful Savior, some very important events and decisions that need to be made. A voting members meeting will be held on Wednesday, June 22nd, 2016 at 7 o'clock p.m. in the Family Life Center. There is one agenda item to be voted on, and that will be after receiving, then voting on a resolution from the Board of Directors regarding construction of new classrooms, large group meeting space, and a columbarium. All members of Beautiful Savior age 18 and older are eligible and invited to participate, and we want you to be there to be part of this important, far-reaching decision that needs to be made. And also in association with this meeting and with this vote, there will be members of the Board of Directors available next weekend after all services, June 18th and 19th, at the Welcome Center in the gathering space to answer any questions which you might have prior to that meeting. That's Wednesday, June 22nd at 7 p.m. in the Family Life Center. So we have the Board of Directors available for questions and conversation following worship next weekend, and then Wednesday, June 22nd, a vote after receiving the report and the recommendation and the resolution from the Board of Directors about proceeding following Kingdom Impact. So please take note of that and join us. Receive the blessing of the Lord before you leave. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
go in peace, live in love as Christ loves us. Thanks be to God.